Hey everyone, Alex from O'Brien here. Restoring older implants can be difficult, especially when most of the restorative components have been discontinued. And this is definitely true for the original IMZ implants, and in this video, I'm going to go over the restorative options you have for that system. The original IMZ is a non-hexed implant, meaning there aren't any anti-rotational elements built into the interface. And this is not to be confused with the IMZ hex head implant that was released later. You can identify the original IMZ radiographically by a few notable features. First, there are no external threads on the implant body. Second, you'll see oblong holes near the apex of the implant. And finally, the internal diameter is fairly big because the IMZ screws are larger than most other implants. And there are just two platform sizes, the 3.3 and 4.0, but we definitely see more of the 4.0. Many, if not most, IMZ implants were restored using an intermediary abutment such as the IME or the UMA. And these abutments are a very similar style to the multi-unit abutment, which is commonly used today. Unfortunately, we can no longer get compatible parts for those abutments, so in order to make a new restoration, you'll first need to remove any intermediary abutment that may be present. IME and UMA abutments can be removed using a unique driver that's made specifically for them. The driver fits over the external hex that's present at the top of the abutment. Okay, so with the limited parts available for this system, I'm going to show you the restorative options you have for single units, splinted units, and for removable prostheses. And the first thing to mention is that these implants are not great for single units. Because that interface lacks an anti-rotational element, the crown will rely on the adjacent contacts to maintain its position. And really, that means that those abutments will almost certainly come loose over time. Attachments International was a company that previously sold a variety of parts for this system, and their implant manual actually mentioned using Teflon tape or a thread adhesive to secure the abutments in place. And I don't mention that as a recommendation, only to point out that this has been an issue with this system since the beginning. For cement-retained restorations, there's really only one abutment that will work for single units, and it's a stock titanium sold by Titan Implants. The abutments are cylindrical with one flat side and a uniform margin height. For the 4.0 implant, it's available with margin heights of 1, 2, 4, and 5 millimeters. And for the 3.3 implant, it's available with just two margin heights of 1 and 3 millimeters. These abutments have integrated screw threads instead of having a separate screw. So when you place these in the implant, you'll be rotating the entire abutment to screw it into place. They also don't have thread timing, which means that every time the abutment is rotated into place, that flat side could be in a different position. So to restore with these, you'll need to seat the abutment and then leave it there. Before you torque it in, however, you'll need to evaluate the height to determine if additional clearance is needed. If necessary, you can remove the abutment to prep it. Once you've determined that adequate space exists, torque the abutment into place and take an impression similar to a crown prep. And again, don't remove the abutment at this point. It needs to be left in place once the impression has been taken. For screw-retained, Titan Implants does sell a castable post, and unlike the titanium abutment, they're designed with a separate screw. It's important to note, however, that these can only be used for PFM or full cast restorations. And the biggest issue with these castable posts is that they're made entirely of plastic, so the entire abutment gets cast into an alloy. And that creates an abutment interface that's less than ideal, and it won't be as precise as a titanium abutment. And this imprecise interface will typically cause more micro-movement of the abutment and increase the rate at which the abutment screw will come loose. In order to use the castable post, you'd need to take an implant-level impression so that a model can be poured with an implant replica. That shouldn't be a problem, but those implant replicas are currently only sold by Titan, and they are commonly out of stock. So to go this route, it's possible you'd have to wait a significant amount of time to get the parts that are needed. For splinted restorations, the restorative options are the same as for single units. The big advantage of splinting these is that the non-hexed interface doesn't create the same problem as it does for single units. And that's because once you splint two implant abutments together, they can no longer freely rotate on the implant. If you're doing a cement-retained bridge, the big disadvantage is that you're going to have to make the abutments parallel. That means you'll have to torque the abutments into place and then prep them in the mouth. And again, that's because every time that abutment gets torqued in, the rotation could be different. Now, if you are splinting one IMZ with a newer implant, this may not be an issue. In that situation, you can torque the IMZ post into place and take the impression over it while using an impression coping for the other implant. The lab will then pour up a model that has an analog for the other implant while the IMZ abutment will be represented in stone. The lab can then scan in the case and design the abutment for the other implant to be parallel with the IMZ abutment. The castable abutments I mentioned earlier will also work for making screw-retained bridges, and in fact, they are better suited to splinting than for single units. And so doing splinted screw-retained is going to be the best way to make fixed restorations for these implants. But as mentioned before, you may run into an issue getting the analogs from Titan. Finally, removable prostheses are the easiest way to go with these implants. Locator abutments are available for the original IMZ, and it's what we would recommend using. They're available in collar sizes of 0 through 5 millimeters for both the 3.3 and 4.0 platforms. And if you aren't familiar with locator abutments, you can check out our locator videos for information on what they are and how to restore them. If for whatever reason you'd prefer to use a ball abutment instead of locator, you can get those from Titan as well. But they do require more vertical space than locator, and they can only accommodate a total divergence of 10 degrees between implants as opposed to the 40 degrees with locator. I hope you found this video helpful, and as always, feel free to contact us with any questions. See you next time.